let's go back. Here we go. On to challenge number 34. Vocal verbing. Hi and hello or something. Where'd my vowels go? Something. Well, the vowels have revolted against us or whatever. All right, so I'm gonna just take everything in the inbox, drop it on the outbox, and see what happens. What is the project? Oh, yeah. Working on a project for a university coursework. It's been ages since we touched JavaScript. Oh. All right, so B-R-A-I-N. And I think it's just telling me remove the vowel. Take the inbox character. Copy it to there. Actually, let's keep it as far from that counter as possible. And we're going to subtract the value in there. Oh, hang on. I get what that zero is for now. Well, how about that? Here's how we're going to do something fancy. So prior to doing that, going to copy from 5 into address 6. Take the letter, copy it there. I guess actually it doesn't matter what order I do any of that in. And then, wait, how do I say go iterate through addresses 0, 1, 2, 3, 4? Okay. Well, this is kind of sad, actually. Oh. No, I'm just playing this with German language settings just to try to make a game of it. If I did this in English, there would be no challenge whatsoever. So, I'm just deliberately making things silly for myself. It'd be nice, though, if I could have some way of saying increment 0 through 4, but I don't have a way to do that. So next it's going to say copy from the address that's in value 6, and if that value is 0, skip over stuff, otherwise do some stuff and then jump back here. So stuff we're going to be doing inside this loop is subtracting the value that we copied into register 9, and if that's 0, we've got a vowel, so just get the next letter. So here's a text search function. Much in the same way that you would see this implemented in C. Oh. Hey, look! I invented an infinite loop. I forgot. We do need to increment the value. Let's see. Copy to. Yeah. So we need to increment that value. That should be fine, though. Put Netflix in German to learn all the time. It's a good way to learn. Yes, this is Zachtronics. Zachtronics makes the silliest, or in my opinion, just a lot of really interesting games. The simulations they make are as adorable as they are entertaining as they are challenging. So, it's just, I'm really impressed with the work they do. And, I mean, this is a great way of showing people how software can work. You build up the program here on the right, you're able to see the person executing it. And look at that! Look at that! I skipped a step, a very important step. When you're going to be putting something in the outbox, make sure it's a letter and not the digit zero. I'm pretty sure this is a Zachtronics game. I'd be really ashamed if I were mistaken on this. What's up with the creepy hand? Well, that's so noisy still. I'm not sure what you mean by creepy hand. Oh, hey, look! I did better in terms of number of steps taken, and I tied the number of instructions taken that they wanted. I was disappointed with the way I did it, frankly. I thought there was a more optimal way I could have implemented that. But I'll take it. Alphabet is... Whoa, what's this? Have we lost a corner of the building? Oh no. Bitte sein Sie sich bewusst, dass diese Freiwilligengang... So, no joke's gonna do all our translation for us. Ja, der Tat Wiedersehen. Ein Hände Nachricht. Sie werden zwei... Okay. Zwei, I think, means two. Ein. The first is something. Eine falsche Spur. One something. One Nobel Prize? I don't know. This is one something. Knight something. The inbox something. Something contains some words. Alphabetize the words and put them in the outbox. That can't be right. Probably means alphabetize the letters that are in each word and pipe that alphabetized string into the outbox. He's saying that I should play Go. Oh. Oh, no. Well, he'd be disappointed to know that I did that already today. Looks like it's not a Zachtronics game. That's a pity. Wow. I'm spellbound that this isn't, but apparently not. Alright, here we go. Here's our loop. Take things from the inbox, put them in the outbox. That's just so ridiculous. I mean, we know what he's asking for. But let's see him complain anyway. So you put the U there, and he's... Oh. What? Unify? Huh. The outbox. Ordnung, aber die, something five objects, not six. The inbox has two words. Print out the word that's alphabetically first of the two and put that into the outbox. Okay, I get it. So that's special. Untie versus unite. Wait, how did he not produce that same message last time? Yeah, the first time this came up, the same word was here twice in the queue. Unite versus unify. Okay. That's funny. Gigantic stack. Well, all right, so pretty much an open book here. All right, so what we've got to do, it's going to be kind of messy. Watch as we build a stack here. So I'm actually going to leave these values alone if I can. I think I can. Yeah, there should be no problem leaving those values as are they are at the moment. And I was going to try to do something fancy that could be generically applied to any number of words. And it just gets too fancy, unfortunately. I want to write a routine that just reads a word, sticks it at the address specified by one of these two addresses. Yeah, so we're going to copy from 23, copy that into 22, or maybe 20, just for my own sanity, we'll stick it over there. Oh, but this is going to cost me extra instructions to do it this way. Well, that's probably okay. Oh, I don't have a way to stick a hard-coded 23 or 24 into one register. That's a problem. Okay, so I have to do this the ugly way. So we're gonna copy from 23 into 22. Inbox copy to the value noted by address 23. Except that's not the one. I want to do this for 22. There we go. That's overkill for sure. And repeat the same business for, let's just use 21, just for clarity's sake. And we're gonna say copy from 24 into 22 and read from the inbox and copy to the thing denoted by the address denoted by the value that's in register 22. Now we need to have loops, because who doesn't enjoy a good loop? So jump up here, unless we're zero, in which case jump down there. And this is gonna keep jumping. Oh, actually, I have this. That jump is higher than it needs to be. There we go. And then if we've got a zero, then we go on to the rest of the program. Yeah. So this program won't actually output anything, but it will read the values into memory, which is an important first step. Also, an important first step is not overwriting the memory that contains the word. So you see, he reads the words into memory. Right, and so now this program is terminated without putting anything into the outbox, which is not what he wanted. So the next step is to compare the words in memory until you discover which word alphabetically comes first. Man, there's a fancy way you could do this. I don't know if this is too fancy. But what you could do is read the first word in and then compare the letters as you're reading them in off of the inbox. And, as soon as you discover which word is alphabetically first, then that's the one that you print out. I want to try it that way. Okay, slot two. So we're going to copy that value over here. Or just to be consistent, we'll stick it in 21, doesn't matter. I'm gonna take the values in the inbox. Copy them into the thing noted by address 21. And yeah, if we're zero, we're gonna jump over the next jump instruction. And the jump instruction takes us back here. Yeah, increment the value there. So that's all well and good. And loop number two is going to read something from the inbox, copy it into, really, you could put it anywhere, but sure, stick it in slot 10. And then, before we do any of that, yeah, here's how we're going to do it. Copy that also into address 22. And then we're going to subtract the thing noted by address 22. Let's see. So we need to handle three possible conditions. Condition A being that the inbox contains the first word, B being that the word in memory contains the first word, and C being that we don't know yet, in which case it doesn't matter which is which. Jump negative. Jump of 0 is going to put us back up here. And that we have to keep reading from the inbox and figure out which word comes first. Jump of negative. I'm not sure if negative means that the one. Negative would mean that the word in the inbox comes first. So that would mean we're going to copy from thing that we originally read, put that in the outbox, and repeat ad infinitum here until we hit a zero. If we hit a zero, we're done. Hang on. So wait. We do this comparison. We have all these jumps if we're zero, whatever, whatever, whatever. Oh, this actually gets complicated, doesn't it? So if we determine that the word in the second word in the inbox is alphabetically first, we want to do it this way. Yeah, this is getting fancy. I'm just enthralled by this possibility somehow. It's a mess, but it's my mess. So if that's first, copy from the outbox. Oh, here's how we do this. We can invert these instructions, giving us one more space in the stack. Oh, that's horrible. And yet functional. Man, this is disgusting. Do not write your programs this way unless you have to write them in assembly, which basically this is assembly. So we've handled two conditions, one where we have to keep reading the words, two, well, hang on. We need to increment the value in register 22. There we go. And condition 3 is the one where the letters in memory already are the answer. So condition 3 is the thing that we skipped over here, which ultimately is going to take us to the very end. But we want to do some things before we jump to the end. Things we want to do are copy from register 22 references a memory address, put that in the outbox. Bump plus of register 22. Oh, this is actually fail if the final character, if the words are identical. That's funny. I hadn't even thought about that until just now. I need to handle that condition too. So, yeah, if we have a zero, we need to skip to the end. Otherwise, keep going in this loop. There we go. Let's see how it does. Blind run. No freaking way this is gonna work. The odds are very much against us. There's no way. Oh, see, that's the beauty of it, is that I'm trying to complete this game. It just occurred to me that this game is a lot harder to complete than I originally thought. Yeah. But yeah, I was gonna say the beauty is that you could. There's another game out there called Shenzhen.io, which has all this crazy arithmetic stuff. No, I failed. Only No Joke understands why I failed. The function is the something. Probably that I put the wrong word there, because unite comes before Unix. Your function makes the spelling something. Yeah. Says yes, er, it gebe something makes the last thing. He likes to use that word damn it a lot. Yeah, I assume that's what he's trying to say, although I didn't think that this was correct either, because I think he's asking for the first of the two words, not the second of the two words. But yeah, I think I've seen this error message also in cases where he says, yeah, you get the right output for this, but in general, your solution doesn't work. But it's such a beautiful solution, you know? Let's see this one more time. Oh, I can't perform the sub operation. Right, that was the other thing I thought about. I forgot to check here. Is that the second time you're reading from the inbox, if you've got a zero, even before all this, you do need to jump to the end. Yeah, so many overlapping arrows. Okay. Yeah. So I actually got a. Yeah, you're right. Oh no, you're absolutely right. That's what confused me. Okay. So we're gonna go back to the easier thing. The one that just all this does is loads the words into memory. If I remember right, that's all it does. Right. So then once you got the words loaded, then compare them. So we're going to read in letter one. Subtract letter two. And if we've got a zero, we're going to keep jumping and looping and looping and looping and looping. Oh, hang on, I still need to copy those zeros into memory if I'm not doing so already. Oh no, I am doing so. That's good. All right, thanks for stopping by. This is going to copy from here and put that in the outbox. So as long as the letters match, it'll print things in the outbox. Can we at least verify that that's what it's doing? I forgot to increment. That's cool. Right, put that in the outbox. Where am I going to put this bump operation? I guess it's going to go here. Bump 23, bump 24. I'm going to end up duplicating this instruction later on, also. But not a whole lot can be done about that. Else, jump if negative. Else, whatever. Well, let's get this wrong exactly half the time and then fix the other half. Let's see, copy from copy to, oh, shoot. In this whole comparison phase, I need to see if one, either of the letters is a zero. Oh my goodness. Man, what a mess. That's incredible. I can think of ways that involve tons of instructions that are efficient for really large address spaces. But coming up with a efficient way to do this is kind of messy. So for this algorithm to work, yeah, if we have a okay. Scrap all this for the moment. Okay. So We're going to want to read the value of each address. If it's zero, just skip to the end. Actually, we don't need to do that for both, just for one of them. And then we can subtract the value in the other address. No, we do need to do that for both. What am I talking about? And if we have a zero in the other address, we're done. Otherwise, take the difference between the two. If it's zero, then repeat all this comparison stuff. So we're going to need to read the value in one of those, put it in the outbox, increment register 23, increment register 24. So as long as things match, we're going to need to keep printing out the matching letters. So at least we get that part. U, N, not a match, and he gives up. So far, so good. Next step. So, if we're not zero, we're going to have a jump if negative instruction. It tells us how to do the one case. Otherwise, we'll have to do the other case. I'm not sure which case is which, so... do it like that. And let's see. There's no jump if positive instruction, unfortunately. Copy from 23, put it in the outbox, increment 23, oops, increment that one, jump back up, read, and this time if we find a zero, we're done. Okay, so our jump if negative takes us here. Going to need to do something very similar where read the letter. If it's zero, we're done. So this is a more beautiful way to render this, isn't it? Not that it matters. It's not a zero, put it in the outbox. Increment and jump back up. Like there. So this is getting it right half the time and failing at the other half. And we'll see which it's doing. U, N, D. Oh, failure. Let's back up. Where did this fail? It reads the O, puts that there, increments that, jumps, and if we got a zero, skips to the end. At the end, we need to put one last thing in the outbox, regardless of how we got there. U. N. I is the wrong letter. So here we branched wrong. Oh, sorry, we did branch correctly, but all the branching code is correct, but it's just taking things from the wrong register here. So this one needs to be 24. And this one needs to be 24. And there we go. What? Oh. You don't want the zero in the outbox. What? Dirt versus units. Okay, I thought that you said you wanted that. Unit or Unix versus UNSET unset. Cool. I'm not sure what he was so confused about earlier. Easy peasy. Easy peasy. All right. Ziff and whatever. Oh. I have something with one stern something. Alright, thanks for stopping by. I'm sorry, you're saying see ya to Mike. I'm getting my comments in the chat window confused. But yeah, that was a good game there. The something something seconds the whereabouts something. Okay, I'm sure there's a cool story behind that all. Nehmen sie zahl in der inbox und legen sie der Ziffern in die outbox. I'm assuming it's just saying decompose the number into hundreds, tens and ones, and print that out as 1, 2, 3. Well, simple. You just take the first digit and you know. That's cool. Wait. Why is he giving me four numbers? Okay. Got a bad feeling about this. No. copy from 9 to 6 to 7 to 8. Read a thing from the inbox. Subtract 100. For negative, skip the next thing. The next thing is going to be increment this. For zero. Ooh. Well, that's fancy. Most cases, we're going to end up just jumping back up here. Again, I'm thinking of more generic ways to handle this that don't require so many instructions, but they actually do require instructions, because keeping track of a counter that would count through subtract this, subtract that. You're not even going to subtract this, by the way. the counter would be just too much of a hassle to maintain on top of everything else. So for zero, skip over the jump. Hey, Vin Vin. Just having some fun, learning some German. Unfortunately, without a drink. Oh well. So, just gonna jump back up here, and we're gonna keep subtracting the 11 and bumping the 8. Just copy from address 8 and put it in the outbox. And then we're going to do the same thing for the tens. Jump if negative down here. Wait, hang on. We ended up with a negative number. We do have one additional responsibility here. And that's re-increment. Where do I put that instruction? We had so much jumping going on. So for negative, we need to re-add the 100 in order to be able to continue subtracting things. Or maybe, maybe I do some tricky math here. Maybe I read the number in, put it somewhere, and subtract it from zero and put it somewhere. Then just add hundreds until we, I don't know. Having a jump if positive instruction would make some of these things so much simpler. But yeah, there's no negate operation. That would also make things simpler. I think 008's probably going to be fine. Well, so yeah, here where we've got this negative thing going on, I still need to re-add the 100 that we subtracted. Oh wait, no, I never saved the result of what I subtracted. So I only need to save that result in the case where we're not skipping over things. See, actually, where am I saving that? By the way, read the thing from the inbox. Need to copy it somewhere. Let's put it there. And then, yeah, if we have a number that's not negative, we need to copy that again. And that way we're not losing our number. Yeah, and then we read the value out of zero and do all this stuff again. So there's no point in being lazy about this. So yeah, let's flesh this out. Subtract the value there. For negative, skip over all the following. Else, copy the result to 0. Bump, increment the value that's in register 7. If we've got a 0, skip over this instruction. The next instruction is going to be jump back up and keep subtracting. So do all those subtraction operations. We actually don't need this value at all. So for negative here, well, regardless, at the end of all this, we're going to be copying the value out of register 7 into the outbox. And then we're going to be copying the value in register 1 or 0 into the outbox. And then rinse and repeat. There we go. 0, 0. Oh, it doesn't want 0, 0, 8. It just wants 8. Okay. So, there you go. Problem solved. I wasn't paying any attention. I was paying absolutely no attention. Let's just watch this again. 0, 0, 75. Subtract the 100. We got a 0. 75. Subtract the 10. We got a 65. Stick the 65 there and increment that. Yeah, that's not the value we want to subtract from. So, bump plus 8. Wait, we're jumping back up here. Copy to 0. Before we do the subtraction thing, we're going to need to copy back out of register 0. And similarly here, another, just reread the value. One 25, 2,63, 742. Oh noes. Ha! No, that's terrible. Yeah, this game's called Human Resource Machine. Oh no. No, that's horrible. He's telling me that for some set of inputs, this program doesn't work. Thanks for the constructive feedback, buddy. Knew I could count on you. Oh my goodness. What possible set of inputs could this fail for? Oh man. That's horrible. Oh, here it is. 102. Oh my god. That is funny. You have a zero in the middle of the number. You still need to print the zero. Yeah. All right. Memory slot 2. We're gonna try this from scratch. Read from the inbox. Copy it somewhere just in case. Subtract 100. If the result is negative, skip over everything. Else. Hang on, we need to initialize some kind of counter somewhere. We actually, yeah, we could mess with this register 9 here. Yeah, that's funny. Oh, but we're gonna need that register later. Never mind. Copy from 9. Let's actually copy it there. Hang on. That should be a copy to instruction. Copy to 1. Subtract 11. If we've got a negative number, skip all the BS. Otherwise, increment the value of register 0. And we're going to go in for the long haul there of printing out a 3-digit number. Yeah, what a mess. Oh my goodness. Yeah, so for this to work, yeah, no, I don't care. I'm doing this in German for fun. So you have to have routines for printing out a 3-digit, a 2-digit, and a 1-digit number. Besides, that's not the problem here. Okay, let's deal with the 2-digit case. For negative, we'll deal with the 1-digit case, which is just read the number and print it, and that's that. We'll add the jump back to the beginning when we're all done. Otherwise, you know, this is like a one-liner in C, basically, to take an integer and print it as a string. You just use the print command. It's pretty simple. Now, as for how the core library does it, well, that's fun. But, yeah, doing this in C, you just, it's the print command. That's all it is. Printf, to be specific. Otherwise, here we're going to increment the value in register 0. And keep jumping and jumping and jumping here. So if we're 0, we don't... No, if we're 0, we still do an increment. Interesting. This game is, at least, I took the fork on the left, which I think is the more challenging path. And this puzzle takes focus. Right, so I want to copy the result back into register one. I want to do that up here as well. Okay, so keep incrementing that. Here we go. Okay, so that's a two digit. Pretty confident about that. So I need to handle the three digit case. So we need to have a loop here. That just keeps us jumping back up there. Now this is going to need to have a special handler for the case where we need to print the middle digit. That's the key. Copy to one, bump, copy to one, bump, etc., etc. It's going to need to, hang on, damn mouse, subtract. Oh wait, I'm doing an extra subtraction here, aren't I? Yeah, we need to fix this. Don't do the subtraction until we're ready for it. Something like this. Copy to one, increment counter, copy from one, sub 10. That looks appropriate. Jump back up there. If we hit a negative number here, then we skip all this. And we copy from zero into the outbox, and copy from here into zero. And this is why I should have initialized things properly to begin with. I need to initialize two counters, not one. That's my fault. So I'm going to change all these ones to twos. That one's going to be a two. This one's going to be a two. This one's going to be a two. Make all the ones into twos. Now that we've done that, now that all the ones are twos, we can use this other register one. You'll see in a second how we use this. That allows us to eliminate an instruction here, namely this stuff. the special handler here is now for the case where, hang on. So, for less than 100, we skipped over all this, we're not printing out anything. For less than 10, in this case, before we make this big old jump, we're going to need to also check what's the value in the hundreds register, which is register 0. And if that contains a value, then we need to print out the tens digit. That's the tricky part here. So I could add that check in over here, I suppose. So for less than 100, skip all the way down here. Else, we're going to subtract the value in register 10, which happens to be a 10. And if we're negative, man, I wish there were a way to say jump if not negative, but, if we're negative, we're going to jump past a jump instruction. Let's just say, copy this and print it out. There's got to be a better way. I don't like this at all. I'm going to see if I can find a better way to do this. This seems like the best scope to do it in, though, because we know that we printed out a hundreds digit. I want to reuse some of this if I can. The other possibility is here, we have our jump if negative instruction. There's really no best way to handle this. Because there's no... I'm lacking the exact instructions that'd be really helpful here. Yeah, now I could repeat the check, like, if my hundreds digit contains something. I can certainly do that. You're whatever. No, Now, the deal is, so like I've subtracted the 100, but I've already cached the old value away in memory address 2. So I reread the value out of 2 when I'm done. Like right here. Then we subtract the 10. The thing is, I want to add something extra here somehow that catches the condition where we've got a zero in the center digit. So if we're less than 100, that puts us. So we printed out a digit here. Here's our hundreds digit. I mean, I could show you what this is doing. And you'll observe quite obviously where the bug is. The problem has nothing to do with the hundreds digit. See, we got a 1 there, and we subtract another 100, and so we cache that, and then we got 2 there, and then we do this again, and we got a 3 here, and then we take the number and we subtract 100, and so yeah, we've got the 4 right there, and then we see that our 4 is the number of hundreds. Then we take the 4 and subtract 10, we get negative 6. That's not even the value I expected us to print out, but you get the idea. Oh no, it printed out the final digit and it missed the center 0, is the point. So it has nothing to do with negatives or hundreds. Has everything to do with the fact that if we printed out a hundreds digit, then we also need to print a tens digit. Or if we're electing not to print a tens digit, before we elect not to print that, double check what the value in the hundreds digit was. But make sure not to repeat the tens digit if doing the check. Hey. No, that was the first thing I did. The thing is, for a single digit number, it wants only a single digit printed. That was my original approach, and that's not what it wants. It wants just literally what you see here: 805, 805, 55, 55. I 856, 856, 88. That's what it wants. So it does not want any leading zeros. So that's the challenge. So I'm trying to deliberate what's the best way to improve this program to print out the center digit of this 805. I honestly think that the best place to do it is right here. I'm just being really finicky about. Hang on. Yeah, so we need to read the number, subtract 10, which happens to be an address 10, but. And then if we're 0 or if we're negative. No, I'm sorry, if we're negative, then print out a 0. Otherwise, jump over the printing of a 0. I just really don't like this extra instruction that's going on here, but my instruction set is pretty weak. So, copy from the 0 number. And just print it out. and this works. I just don't like it, and I feel there must be a better way to do it. But this works. I just don't like it. I feel there must be a more efficient way to do this. And this off by one stuff get, and if you were to do it using an off by one technique like you're describing, you'd probably end up doubling the size of the program. And perhaps even the instruction count. So you probably want to try to keep things simple rather than inventing a new way of doing it. Yeah. It's worth seeing what their goal is. So here we got 5 minus 10. And print out the 0. Print out the 5. Oh, really? Wait, how did that sub-zero get there? What in the world? My mouse must have really acted up there. There we go. Let's try this again. I just feel that this could be better done. So, yeah. I was correct in thinking there's a better way to do this. Both from an instruction count perspective and from the perspective of just the number of steps it took. So, in particular, the fact that we're doing so many jumps is quite a hassle. We'll try attempt number 3. Just for the sake of trying something way out of the box. So let's copy from 9. Put that into registers 0 and 1. Read from the inbox. Get into 2. Oh, but then you need to twice subtract 2. Man. I was trying to think of an efficient way of reading the number from the inbox and getting its negation. But the most efficient way to negate the number is this. You can't just negate while reading. So we've used up a few instructions already. And then we need to copy the result into there. But okay, we'll start with this and see where we end up. No reason to get too pessimistic just yet. Oh, but now I don't have a jump if positive instruction. So yeah, this is just not the way to go. Yeah, I don't like this at all, but I'm trying to think of a better way. Maybe you can immediately. That was my first approach. Really, what would be helpful would be a division operator. I'm not getting that, am I? It's a good way to go about this. We need to cache this. Maybe the problem is, yeah, I'm doing a ton of reads and writes to that address. I mean, it's sufficient, it works. I'm just not satisfied with it. Obviously, at some point, I do need to copy that value into here. Not need to do that. So then we're going to subtract the 100 for negative. Did I do anything stupid in this middle loop? No, after I printed out the hundreds digit, only then did I do the subtracting the 10 thing. Jump if negative would skip printing the hundreds digit. Maybe I do an increment early, and then do a decrement if things fail. Let's try that. Wow, that is a premature bump there, isn't it? That's not even where I want to put the loop. Yeah, I guess it doesn't matter where I put this bump instruction. Wait, what are the odds that I hit a number that's divisible by, or that's, you know, this equal to zero jump that I had in the middle of the program is super unlikely to occur. So maybe there's a better way I can handle that condition. So for negative, jump down here. subtract 11. If we're negative, again, jump down here. Oh, so that jump if 0 thing is unnecessary. Okay, copy. Gonna go delete this number 3 and then paste. And then this whole stuff I'm doing about constantly checking is my value equal to 0 doesn't need to be done, does it? Wait, do I not have a equal to 0 check? I don't actually need it. Wow, I thought I had one. I just imagined it. Negative, jump all the way the heck down here. Subtract 11. Jump, and if we're negative, jump again. Why am I doing it this way? I could just do it this way. It's the same exact thing, but less confusing. This similarly jumps. I could just move this down here. It's the same exact thing. I was jumping more than I needed to. Well, no, it's the same. It should have the same runtime, though. More or less. I mean, this should be a very, very slight improvement over the last version. Ever so slight. Same number of instructions. It's 201. My previous number was more than 201. This looks less bad, but it might be the fact that I'm immediately printing the numbers that might be the problem. Maybe I should calculate the 3 digits and then print them out one by one, based on what their values are. That seems counterintuitive. Extremely counterintuitive. I don't like it at all. Well, no, the one thing in its favor of not printing out the digits right away is that it simplifies some of the reading. Okay, let's copy this. I'm going to overwrite my first attempt, which had the wrong requirement anyhow. And yeah, possibly saving all the printing for last could save a ton of headache. I'm not sure. Maybe I take a break from this particular puzzle and come back to it when I don't know. This is tricky. Everything works, it's just there's got to be a more logical way to organize some of this. particular, this jump if negative, then jump thing. I used to be really proficient at finding a better way to write that, which involves rearranging things on the stack a little bit, which is okay. Jump if negative, jump. Okay, let's skip to the bottom half of this. Maybe I can at least optimize some of this. Jump if negative, else jump up here. If negative, do this stuff. Yeah, so if we're done, print out the number. Okay, I could move these copy from 2 and print to outbox. Move that to the top, right? Because that's something that's... I mean, it doesn't matter, though. In fact, that would cost me an extra instruction to move that. Okay, I have an idea. It's gonna scrap most of this. The idea is that I want to move the printing routine up to the top. And I could have printing routines that print the hundreds, tens, and ones, the tens and ones, and the ones. And in fact, this is what jump instructions could handle very well for us. So we have to have one additional jump up here to skip this initialization routine thing. Which would print out, the values in registers L1 and 2. And then you can make sure that you're jumping to the appropriate spot up here based on what there is to be printed. That would simplify the rest of this business. Like that. Okay. So copy from 2. Subtract 10, and if we have a negative result, then we want to just print out the ones digit and we're done. Hang on, no, in this case we want to print out the tens and the ones digits. Tens and ones digits. There we go. Actually, hang on, we don't even need this intermediate step anymore. Do we? I don't think so. Okay, so the rest of this is getting kind of complicated. Undo. Undo. Okay, we'll figure this out. Because the printing routine is going to look almost identical in all these cases. Okay, let's start with the nominal case where we subtracted 100 and we ended up with a negative number. And then we just need to make sure we subtract all the tens. Well, first of all, if we end up with a negative number immediately, then we call the print routine, printing just the ones digit. Okay. Otherwise, we've subtracted 10. Copy the result into 2, increment the tens digit. Copy from there, subtract 10 again, and once we've hit a negative number, then print out the tens digit and print out the ones digit. Do we need an additional jump instruction to take us way back up to the beginning? I don't think so. I think our existing jump instruction we have at the end is sufficient. That eventually this will get a negative number. So, subtracted 10, we've got a negative number right away. Just print out the ones digit. Okay. Other case. We subtracted 100 and we did not get a negative number. Take the number minus 100, put it in the into register 2. Increment the hundreds counter. So increment the hundreds counter, subtract another 100, and keep looping until such time that okay. Yeah, keep looping until we've finally gone negative. Copy from 0 to outbox does not need to be here anymore. Yeah, this is the tricky stuff down here. I'm going to just take out all this tricky jumping business here. So this is now no longer handling the case where we have a 0 in the middle of the number. negative. There's going to need to be something intelligent in this particular case. Do I need two jump if negative commands? I don't. That works just as well. This also works just as well, I think. Where does that put us? Print out the tens and the ones. Can I just assume that I always want to do that? And so the problem is now if I have a two-digit number, rather if I have a one-digit number, that's a problem. Checked 100. If we've got another, if we've got a negative number, jump down here. Read the number. If we've got a negative number, print out the tens and the ones digits. It's not exactly right. Is there a better way to handle this? For less than 100, go do all that business. Yeah, maybe we do reintroduce the tricky stuff here. Copy from address 2. Subtract a 10 that's in register 10. If we're negative, then print out the tens and ones digits, else this is just going to print out the ones digit, right? No, that's wrong. Or is it? So here we got our, take the number, subtract 10. If the middle digit's a 0, do that. If we're negative, then just print out the ones digit here. Alright, so where do we get? Oh, here it is. This is where we need to print out everything. Like that. 31 instructions. So I saved 4 instructions. Hopefully I got it correct. Oh, damn it. Right. Oh, okay. Okay, so. This stuff about printing the hundreds digit is not going to follow the same pattern as everything else. I see what's going on. Wow. That's cool. Okay, so for negative, we skip over this whole deal here. So we're gonna keep looping until we have the negative jump. And this is the part in the program, line 23, where we want to print out the hundreds digit. We don't need to do that here. That's the catch. Hundreds digit is special in its way of being handled. Okay, so I broke it. Let's back up. If I can back up. Negative, skip all this, else keep subtracting until okay, and then when we end up down here, copy from zero is what I was suggesting and print it out. Copy from two, if the middle digit's a 10, we want to print out those two digits. We don't need to do any printing like that up here. I want to see this in action again. Okay, so we loaded up those two zeros. Take this 540, subtract the 100, put the 5 over here, basically. So there's our 5. Take the 40, subtract 10, increment that, increment that. Just keep subtracting the 10 over and over. Oh, I only have a jump if negative instruction. I think that's still okay though. 40. And then we subtract that, and then we print out the 4, and we print out the 0. Then we gotta put those zeros back. 96. Subtract the 100. Oh no. Right, so we only want to print out the hundreds digit if it's not 0. Okay, anything else? But yeah, I think I was able to reduce the number of branching commands or jump commands in the program. Should have had a 1 instead of a 0. Wait, how? Where did this go wrong? Zero, zero, 25. That's negative, so we can't use that. 25 minus that, put the increment that. There. Okay, so then we print out the 2, and we print out the 5, load in our zeros, got a 1, hundredths digit, nope, got a 1, tens digit, so we jumped up to there when we should not have because we had a single digit number. Okay. So we don't print out the hundreds. Oh. Wow, so this special, really super special handling case. Wait, how did we end up here? How did we end up here? My instructions are completely out of order, aren't they? It should be more like that. Okay, let's put that back. For negative, we're skipping over all of this. All of this should include that routine for printing out the hundreds digit. Subtract 10. We've got a negative number. Print out just the ones digit, and we're done. Let's try this. Alright, I was not paying attention. I need to pay at least the slightest bit of attention. I just completely dazed off. So, what's the deal? $5.98, huh? What did I just seriously goof? Oh, I'm missing a... Yeah. This is... 598. So we're over that. We skip all this. If we're... When we do jump negative, it puts us up to the top. That's super premature. That's only printing, it's skipping, it's printing of the hundredths digit. Good gravy, what the heck is going on here? What am I doing? Okay. Keep jumping and looping. We need a separate jump instruction here somewhere. Something like that. So we're up to 33, our high number of instructions is 35. Subtract 11, subtract 100. If we got negative, don't do any of this incrementing stuff. Just go down here. And in the event that the number does not have, or the tens digit is zero, skip to the top. Why do I have that? This is where we should be printing out the hundreds digit, by the way. Seven oh six, 17, 99, 89, 79, 69, 59, 50, 49, 39, 29, 19, 9, 99. There we go. We have a solution. It's better. Two hundred one steps. Apparently my record was still 201. We did get rid of some jumps by reordering the jumps. Still, there's got to be a better way. Just got to jump way the crap down there. Where does this one come from? Over here. I get the sense. The only case where we want to print a single digit is if you subtract 100, you're less than 0. Subtract 10, you're less than 0. That might be worth checking for up front rather than in the middle of all this stuff. Copy to 2. If your number's less than 10, just print it out, is the gist of it. So I could take this routine that we got in the middle here. Let's copy from 2 sub 10, jump if negative. Could just emulate that earlier up here. So copy to 2, sub 11. But before we do that, well, let's copy from to here. Sub 10 for negative. Just print out the ones digit and go. That's the only case where we want to print out the ones digit. We don't need to do that check down here anymore. This probably simplifies the entirety of the rest of the program. So let's deal with this case down here. Negative is going to take us back up to the top there. Here we've got another jump if negative that also takes us to that same location. So can combine those two jumps. See. Here we print out the hundreds digit and copy from address 2. Where else does that get done? So the first thing we did is we checked. Do we end up with a negative number? If so, copy, reread the number, subtract 10. If we ended up with a negative number here, then jump way up to the top and print out the two remaining digits. We've already tested for the condition where or we got something negative. I'm sorry, where we got a single digit. That was the first thing we checked for. Okay, reread the number, subtract 100. If you end up with less than 100, go down there. Otherwise, count the number of hundreds, figure that all out. But here, read the number, subtract the 10. If we end up with a negative number, then we're done. Okay. Well, this is better, I think. This is not at all the way I would code it in C, by the way. I'm curious how they do code it in C now. Just because branching instructions are super expensive. You don't want to code it with an upfront check for is my number less than 10. Do we have fewer than 201? No, we actually increased the number of steps taken. Again, my record was 201, but we have one fewer instruction this way. Subtract 100, if you're negative, do that. Else, copy the subtracted number, bump the counter. Let's see, we bump the counter. Wait, where does this jump go? This jump takes us down there, past the printing out of the number. Makes sense. It's just sad that there's not a better way to do this loop, but I'm assuming that that's as tight as it can get. Okay, this is the beginning after we subtracted the 100. We ended up a number less than 100, then go down here. Reread the number. Oh, hang on, we got two extra instructions here. We're doing this twice. Okay. Yeah, there's a slight performance penalty of that now, isn't there? Hopefully that helps quite a bit. I couldn't understand where the extra 25 instructions between 201 and 226 came from. Now I have an idea. Yeah! Nice, 29. 199, personal record. So that's progress. My goodness, that was a really simple detail. The fact that we were repeating these two instructions above and below just because of how things got reordered so many times. In one case, during reordering, I forgot to remove the duplicate. Oh well. Copy from 2, sub 10. For a negative, go up to the top and print out the numbers. Copy to 2, bump 1. Just, yeah, that seems fine. Jump if negative, just print out the hundreds digit right away. Jump takes us there. So this whole check if our number is less than 10 deal. Could I actually move that up here? So our first thing is check if it's less than 10. If so, just print it out. Else, check if it's less than 100. So I could move that less than 10 thing below the less than 100 check. Couldn't I? Not sure if it's a good idea, but I could. So less than 100 go down here rather than up there. Oh, but this falls through. Yeah, so no, the way I ordered it makes some sense. Curious what the best way to do this is. We've made a ton of progress with this particular challenge. It's really astounding how much progress we made. So this jumps from all the way down there to print out two digits. This prints out one digit. I could move those commands toward the bottom of the program. I mean, you see how loosely connected some of this stuff is. I could move all that. The purpose of moving that would be to try to remove an instruction. So. Yeah, the tens and ones digit could be printed out at the end here. Oh, wait, but jump if negative takes us up to the top. Prints that out. Whereas otherwise, the jump if negative would have to take us to something below line 29. I'm making a much ado about nothing here. basically what would happen is I'd move these 8-ish lines of code just to the end of the program instead of the beginning. It wouldn't make any functional difference, as far as I can tell. So I need to reduce the number of steps that this executes by. I've actually, they want you to do this in 30 instructions, and I did it in 29. But I'm now trying to figure out, is there a way to reduce the running time cost of the program? See if I can get it to execute faster by virtue of, presumably not jumping as much. One thing I could move would be that whole tens routine. I could move that up to the top. Again, that doesn't matter. None of the changes I've thought of so far are anything but cosmetic. Since my last improvement. Like, I could say here, if our number is less than 100, jump all the way up to the top, and at the top declare all this stuff about what to do if your number's, once your number's less than 10. This was the key discovery, is that the first thing you should check absolutely should be, is the number less than 10? If so, just print it. That's the key discovery right there. The rest is kind of immaterial. I'm going to copy this into slot 2. And I'm going to take this big old routine at the bottom and stick it up at the top. So copy from 2, subtract 10, all this stuff is going to move. I think. Or let me start by just taking this printing routine and move it to the bottom. Along with this silly jump. Copy from 1 to outbox, copy from 2 to outbox. Let me just put that at the end. Just so it's all in one place. And then when you're done, then you jump back up like this to where this jump command is taking you, which is over here. So now this jump if negative doesn't need to take us to the printing routine up here, because it can take us to the printing routine at the bottom. And this jump if negative that just prints the ones digit can do so down here. Like that. And then we don't need these 5 at the top. They might save a single instruction. But more importantly, it really helps with the program's organization. So my record was 199, this is 202. I'm not sure that every execution takes the same number of instructions, but this does help the program's organization, so I like it this way better. Let's see, is there anything else I could do to, like, not use so many registers? Yes, I could use register one throughout this entire business because now we're printing out the hundreds digit in the middle of the program, right? It's doable. this is a mess. Wait, no, I can't subtract. You know, there's no way to reinitialize the register back to zero in a single instruction. So proactively assigning two zeros is fine. Besides that, that has nothing to do with the running time. It has, like, jack to do with the running time of the program. Algorithmically, something could be done better. I just haven't pinpointed what. Read the number, subtract 100, increment the digit. The only other thing that could maybe be done is pre-incrementing the digit or something so that maybe some read instructions could be saved later. I don't know if that would help. Like, could bump the value in register 9 prior to doing any of all this business. And that way we would need to do one fewer increment during a loop. Just to show you what I'm thinking of, we're going to copy this, go into slot 3. Purge this program, paste, and preceding the entire world here, do a single bump on that register. So we're going to have a 1 in each counter. So less than 10, just print out the number. Subtract it. Okay. For less than 100, skip this whole business. Else. Increment that. Bump that, so there's another subtraction. There's gotta be a way to save a bump. Right? I don't know. Copy to 2. I'm just feeling like there's got to be some one-off thing that can be done. I just don't know what. Subtract 100. Or would it be... we want to have a negative 1 in that register. And that would mean that prior to doing the subtraction operation, we'd want to do a bump. Um, I'm not going to move these around at this point. We're just going to do it this way. Subtract, and if we're negative... oh. Else... Well, no, there's no avoiding the fact that there's going to be four instructions in each loop. Maybe I need to think out the memory mapping of this program a little bit differently. Wouldn't that be strange? Huh. Yeah, I don't know. Copy from 2, subtract 10. Wow, you could do some really fancy things with loop unrolling. Do some really fancy things with loop unrolling that get messy. But a jump relative instruction would be helpful for that. Oh, but ultimately what would be helpful is if... you can't do the comparison to see whether you've mathed properly. Yeah. I was going to say it'd be really helpful if somehow you could do the comparison on the quantity but have the counter in memory. But that's not happening. Not by a long shot. There's so many cool things you could do with this, but most of them would change the instruction count, like way through the roof. Like, you get the memory space here, you could be subtracting by not just 100s, but you could be subtracting by 200s, and doing multiple increment operations, and then when you've exceeded the threshold, then just back off and only increment by 100. That's a possibility. It's probably more beneficial to do that with the tens digit, as most numbers will have a tens digit. Only some of them will have a hundreds digit, but anyway. Yeah, food for thought. What's the best way to do this? Well, it appears we're probably not going to find it tonight. We made a lot of progress with this anyway. And I can see from a browser extension that possibly my online status is not necessarily online at the moment. I'm not sure. Could just be that plugin. Anyhow, yeah, it's been a fun exercise. Maybe next time we take a look at Prime Fabric. And or work our way up the main track here. I'm not sure what lies beyond. So, time will tell. What a great soundtrack, too. Although it can get overwhelming after a while, I assume. Yeah. Progress. Woo! Yeah, I'm missing TIS 100. Developing a better appreciation for it, although I like this game's graphics better. But yeah, hope you enjoyed. Thanks for watching. And man, just think, once we've completed this game, what lies beyond? Well, for one, Shenzhen.io. That's gonna be a whole fun business in itself, too. Also, I can't. It's a shame. I think I have completed this Dreierordnung, but I've not met either of the goals. So there's a lot of room for improvement along the way. Yeah, when I first started solving these, I thought you had to meet both the instruction count and runtime steps goals with the same program, and that's not necessary. It's fine to meet one or the other and write programs for both purposes. But yeah, this is Human Resource Machine. If you enjoyed, I don't know, maybe consider supporting the developer, getting it yourself, recommending it to friends. It's a good game. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you around. Do-do-do.